Are we doing the malt mention straight away?
Straight away.
Oh,
Angus.
God, okay. Malt masochists.
Malt masochists.
There we have it. Malt masochists introducing this Ralphie vlog here at ralphie.com. I don't have a video number, a vlog reference number. We'll annotise at the bottom because this is one of our on-location recordings. I know how much you appreciate them. And we're back again at Mulberrybank Auction House in Glasgow because Angus here is having a vintage and antique whisky tasting tonight, are you not?
I am indeed, yes. It's going to be excellent.
It is. We'll talk a wee bit about that later on, but first of all, we're going to start off by introducing, I'll introduce one bottle, Angus will introduce two bottles, and that will get our conversation rolling, because I have had requests for me to come back here to Mulberrybank, because people have been very impressed by Angus's knowledge, and we want to share a wee bit more of that, because apart from knowledge, experience as well, and the fact that we've been engaging with all so many whiskies over the years.
Absolutely, yes.
Ralphie's bottle first. I shall hold it forward, let you see. This is a bottle that I first encountered about 12 years ago, when you could buy it for about £80 to £85 a bottle. I bought one bottle, enjoyed it so much that I bought another two bottles. I've finished one bottle, I've only got two left. If this wasn't so expensive now, I'd probably buy another. It's Rare Malt Selection St. Magdalene 19-year-old from a lowland distillery, which is now a block of flats. It's called Linlithgow Distillery, and if you're ever taking this train from Glasgow through to Edinburgh, or in reverse from Edinburgh through to Glasgow, if you look out from the window of the train on your way in or out of Linlithgow Station, you will see the distillery. You cannot miss it. It's got that very visible turret.
The pagoda.
The pagoda, that's the one. So that's my recommendation from a big whisky auction. Angus has two recommendations. Your first recommendation.
Well,
Angus,
you're going back a few years there. My first one would probably be this. It's a Scotch Malt Whisky Society bottling, an older one, number 99.2, which is from Glenugie Distillery. A lot of people... Well, for a lot many years in recent times, people didn't know anything about Glenugie. It was just another one of the many underappreciated, underloved, unknown distilleries. It's up near Peterhead, the northeast coast of Scotland. It's a Highland coastal distillery. Mm-hmm. And when you start to actually get your hands on a few of these, they're very rare. You don't get many Glenugie bottlings. When you start to actually get your hands on some and taste them and get to grips with what the distiller is like, it's such a beautiful whiskey. It's so fruity, it's so coastal. It's kind of like a cross between Old Bemore and Old Style Clynelish, in that it's big, waxy, mineral, coastal driven whiskey, but it's also got these fantastic tropical and green fruit complexity notes sort of running right through it. It's really beautiful. Mm-hmm. This one was bottled in 1992 and distilled in 1978, making it around about 14 years of age. Mm-hmm. And was matured in, I mean, you never know, but what looks to me like probably maybe a refill sherry cask. Mm-hmm. But yeah, beautiful whiskey, and something at auction would be great either for collecting, but even better for drinking if you were looking to get something particularly special.
Yeah. Good point there. Auctions are not just for collecting, they are an opportunity to source bottles which are no longer available in retail shops. And mention of Glenugie, Angus has really kind of pinned it down, waxy, minerally, and some kind of green notes come through it. It's a particular style of single malt which is full of character and typical of the east coast of Scotland. You get a lot of characters, standout characters, from the east coast.
Yes. There's one of them. Although you're not east coast, are you?
West coast, yes.
So am I. My second choice, which is something, is completely different. It's the other end of the scale. This is a really special, quite unique bottle, ideal for anyone who's looking to really put a showpiece in their collection. It's a bottle of Mortlach. There's no age on it. There's not many details about what's inside the bottle, except that it's old Mortlach whiskey, and it was produced for Germany in the early early 1900s, probably around about 1910, that bottle. But it's got some incredible details to it. Like you can notice on the seal, it would be difficult to see on camera, but on the seal it's got the John Walker lead foil seal. It's got an old driven cork. It's also got a little German import sticker down here. And you notice something that was incredibly rare for the time. It actually states the strength in 43% volume. And back then, normally in UK laws anyway, statements of strength or capacity weren't necessary back then, as early as that. But fantastic piece of history, liquid history.
So what you are in fact saying, Angus, is hold it up and let the whiskey fans see it, but don't you dare drop that bottle.
Basically, yeah.
There you go.
Very, very old whiskey. It doesn't look much. It looks kind of a bit shabby. There's bits in it. The glass looks imperfect, but that's where the real treasure can be found.
Well, that's right. I mean, that's what you look for when you're looking for really old bottles. I mean, these are all hallmarks of this kind of era of bottling and whiskey production, is that you do see hand-blown glass, hand-molded glass. You see these imperfections, little air bubbles. You look at the glass marks on the bottom, and you see this one's brilliant. It's got Walker's registered Kilmarnock whiskey. So back when they were still at Kilmarnock.
Yes.
All that time ago. And, you know, the labels, it's showing its age, it's showing little signs of water damage and aging and fading. But really everything about this is just fantastic. And you mentioned sediment. I mean, that's one of the greatest ways to actually check the authenticity of some old bottles, is to look at the base and see the deposits, see the staining on the glass. You can generally tell that it's quite an old spirit inside when that happens. Most old spirits tended to throw a really slight sediment or a deposit once they've been in bottle for a number of decades. But this is just, for me, this is just exactly what collecting whiskey, but also just enjoyment, love of whiskey is all about. It's an absolute time capsule. It's from an era which is completely gone in Scottish whiskey production. If you were to open it and taste it, if you were really pushing the boat out, then I imagine you'd find something completely special, something completely unlike anything that's produced today, for certain.
Yeah, it's worth noting that Angus has been mentioning there these old, flawed, characterful bottles, and as a whiskey collector myself, I notice having some old bottles is you really start to become aware that the chemical construction of old glass is very different from the glass that's used nowadays, which is far more refined and benefiting from industrial progress. So the old bottle effect, which is increasingly talked about in old whiskey, is going to be different in modern whiskey being produced today, simply because the glass is so different, and not only that, the system of sealing is quite different in many respects too.
These are all part of what contributes to bottle aging, or as something that brandy producers in France referred to for many decades as a taste of glass, and that can come from all number of things, but glass is certainly one of them. I mean, glass for many years was not an inert substance. It is now with, you know, modern glass making techniques, and it has to be with the, you know, mass industrial scale that glass bottles are produced on now. But back in the day when it was hand blown and the chemical makeup of glass was much more basic and much less sort of fixed in place like modern glasses, old style glass would have a very, very small micro crystalline reaction with spirits over decades. It's something that would contribute, no doubt, to a very, very slow change in the spirit, a very, very slow chemical reaction. Also, you have, I mean, the main reason that whiskey evolves in bottle is the internal reactions between all the different chemical compounds, a long chain, short chain molecules, different congeners, different types of alcohol in there. That combined with very, very slow micro-oxidative reactions, which can speed up if you get seepage through the seal. You see different levels on different bottles where some of them start up here, can end up down here, and that can just enhance bottle aging or bottle effect. We call it OBE, old bottle effect, because it isn't always beneficial. Sometimes it can be very cardboardy, something slightly dirty or porridgey.
Particularly in miniatures. You really notice that in miatures.
In miniatures, the biggest problem is because the seals are never as good as on full-size bottles, so you lose the level. And when there's that small amount of liquid in the bottle, that headspace is... The effect is 20-fold almost on the spirit. So they die very quickly, miniatures. It's a great shame because there's some incredible whiskies were bottled in miniatures, particularly by people like Cadenheads, that often weren't in full-size versions. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I mean, on bigger size bottles, the effect can be quite spectacular, especially on peated whiskies, which is why you'll notice old Islay whiskies. If you get an old bottle of Islay whiskey from the 50s, it'll probably sell for a lot more than a bottle of whiskey from maybe a lesser known distillery from a similar era. Not just because they're big name distilleries, but also drinkers now are starting to understand that the nature of these whiskies, the way they changed in bottle, peated whiskey tends to develop better because that extra level of peat character breaks down and just creates all these sort of sub-complexities, little flourishes of phenols, metallic characteristics, all sorts of different aspects on smokiness and medicinal qualities, all these things. It's quite spectacular if you ever get to try one, which you can do. You know, you still can find these things to taste. It's not cheap, and you maybe have to go to some of the big festivals like the Lindora's Whiskey Festival in Ostend or the Limburg Festival in Germany. Mm-hmm. But you can find these old bottles, and really it's a remarkable drinking experience, and you completely understand these ideas of production change, historical styles of whiskey making and bottle aging when you start to taste these whiskies. Mm-hmm. It really opens, and that's what the tasting tonight is about, is really trying the old bottles and understanding why they're different and why they're desirable.
Mm-hmm. Talking of tonight's tasting, Angus, it's very few who can afford the substantial premiums that are paid for seriously old and reputable bottles of whiskey. Now, it's a sign of the times. We're all aware of change, maltmates, but it's the speed of that change. I think that's what catches even experienced people out. Things are moving so fast, but we are in the information age, after all. But if you cannot afford to spend hundreds of pounds, euros and dollars on a very old bottle, or even want to take the risk on a very old bottle of 1950s Ardbeg, one way that you can get to experience some seriously old spirits is by attending an pre-auction tasting. Now, we're very fortunate in Scotland in that we have an auction house here, Mulberrybank Auctions in Glasgow, which has organised this. And this isn't the first time, this is the second time.
Fourth
time, yes. Yes, I'm struggling to keep up. I will catch up eventually after things have moved on. It's all part of the rustic charm, maltmates. You know that. We're sharing the journey. We're all behind the times, thank goodness. And it's a wee bit dearer. It is dearer for the ticket for these tastings. But even numpties like myself, we get along because it's an opportunity to get to taste these old spirits, which I would not personally buy myself. I think there's an awful lot of variety and options currently being produced around the world. But for the keen whiskey drinker, it's an option, and it's one that many take. Well, so what's on the menu tonight?
On the menu tonight, we've got 8 drams, not all of them whiskey. We've got one liqueur in there as well. We've got an old liqueur from the 1930s called Glen Mist. It's a whiskey liqueur, and it's really spectacular. Liqueurs age in bottle almost better than most other spirits, in fact. I mean, that's why bottles like old Benedictines and particularly old Chartreuse are so expensive, because they do develop. The maceration techniques used to produce them mean they develop beautifully in bottle, and this one has absolutely done so as well. I tried it the other day. It's fantastic. We've also got an old Glendullen 12-year-old made at the original Glendullen distillery, bottled in the late 70s. I've got a Longmorn 10-year-old, an official from the early 70s, and I've got a Tullibarden 1964, 27-year-old, bottled by Cadenheads in 1992. I've got an old blend whiskey called Highland Queen Grand 15, which was bottled by MacDonald and Muir in the late 1940s. Mm-hmm. Again, a really fantastic whiskey, which shows bottle aging and how the quality of basic blends has just changed so drastically over the years. And to crown it all off, before we crown it off, we've got a really nice Glenlivet, a 21-year-old private bottling done in the late 70s, really dark sherry, distilled in the 50s, fantastic. And then after that, we've got a beautiful, absolutely stunning old Macallan, 100-proof 10-year-old bottled by Gordon MacPhail in the 70s. Really incredible.
Excellent stuff. Well, thank you very much, Angus, as always.
Back to one point before we finish. You're talking about price of the tastings. It's £40 for the ticket. Sometimes it goes up, sometimes it goes down, depending on what we get in. But I think you go to other tastings and you pay maybe £10, £20, something like that. But you come to this one and you're getting 8 different spirits of incredible quality. And it's something that you often won't get to try anywhere else, let alone side by side like that. And I think that's actually incredibly good value for £40, because I mean the value of the bottles combined is often £1,500, £2,000, something like that. So it's a great opportunity to try these extinct styles of whiskey. No one makes whiskey like this anymore, and it's beautiful.
Absolutely, Angus, well said. And now you know more makes why I bought a ticket. So I'm just going to, we're going to close things off now. I'd like to explain two Scottish words that have been used here that for non-English first language speakers might need a bit of interpretation. First is Peterhead, that Angus has mentioned earlier. It's Peterhead, which is a significant fishing port north of Aberdeen. And the second is Numpty, which I use to refer to myself. Quite lovingly, you understand. A numpty is someone who is a well-intentioned idiot, and I'm quite happy with that mantle. This is fun, and I keep it that way. And a final mention for your website, because Angus does the written blog stuff. I prefer the video still because it's just I'm more lazy, but far more articulate than I would ever be with my written stuff. I just cut and paste. What's the name of your website?
Our website or my blogging website?
Your choice, you can mention
both. We'll do both. It's mulberrybankauctions.com. Mm-hmm. That's for the auction house, and you get all the updates about when our next auctions and tastings are through there. And where I blog is at whiskeyonline.com/blog. I write the blog for Whiskey Online, although I haven't updated it in quite a while because I'm just so busy. But I will get around to it after the auction and I've shipped everything off and everyone's quieting down. I'll start writing something again, I'm sure.
Excellent stuff. Thank you very much, Angus. Thank you for watching. And I'm just going to pick up my bleeper. I've changed the battery, so it will work this time. So a wee kind of passing reference to these lovely bottles behind us, which will be appearing at auction at some point.
Yes, they will. Over the next year, it's a big collection of Macallan that will be appearing over the next year throughout the auctions. But it's, there's almost every great bottling since the end of the Second World War in this collection. So I'm very excited. It's really amazing. We'll be opening a couple as well. So yes.
I'd probably buy one myself, but I expect I would be totally outbid.
Yeah, there's not. Nothing on these shelves is really going to go for less than about £800. So you might be struggling on that one. I can't afford it. That's why I work here. Otherwise, I'd be buying.
Thanks for watching, folks, and we'll see you soon.